The ocean is not the ocean. It's never been the ocean, will never be the ocean. At no time is the ocean the ocean. The ocean is not the ocean. The ocean is not the ocean. The ocean is not the ocean. It's never been the ocean. Never will be the ocean. Not the ocean at any time. Even time is not time. The ocean is not the ocean. The ocean is not the ocean. Welcome. The ocean is not the ocean. I managed to get that up there. It wasn't easy. The ocean is not the ocean. The ocean has never been the ocean. The ocean will never be the ocean. At no time is the ocean the ocean. Even time is not time. Time is not time. At no time, it's time, time. At no time is perception, perception. Spent the day doing these exercises, and it's incredibly profound. And it's tilting things in a certain way. Everything is like tilting now and shifting and changing, because I'm seeing it. It's possible, actually, if one does these exercises to actually succeed in changing perception. This is like a rehearsal for choosing a new perception. It's a literal rehearsal, and I'm doing it. I'm able to do it, and it got very profound today. I did it just while driving during the daytime. This tree is not a tree. This road is not a road. At no point in time is this road ever a road. And keep doing that. In other words, you're taking out the thingness of everything. It's never a road. It's in the new perception, it's only one, oneness. There's only oneness is there. There's no road there. There's no tree. There's no ocean. There's only the oneness. That's all that's being experienced. Everything else is, as it were, devoid of anything, empty, as it were. That doesn't mean one is empty. One is completely full of oneness, but the thingness is devoid. Everything is devoid of thingness. So it is the neti-neti approach, but I'm able to do it in a fresh, strong way right now. Now, what came to me today is this is a rehearsal. This is a rehearsal for choosing a new perception. And it can actually go very rapidly. I've only been doing it for, 5 days or so. And very profound. It's getting easier and easier, and able to apply it in more and more general terms, larger and larger terms. Even this planet is not this planet. This planet has never been this planet. Even God is not God. God has never been God. God is not. In other words, the concept, the idea, the image we have of God is not God. The image we have of Jesus is not Jesus. I say Jesus is not Jesus. Jesus has never been Jesus. Jesus never will be Jesus. At no time is Jesus ever Jesus. Meaning at no time is the conceptual image we have of Jesus actually Jesus at all. At no time is the conceptual image we have of anything actually useful to us in any way. Only the vision of oneness corrects the continuity problem. So seeing things, no matter whether it's God, seeing our image of things, God, Jesus, the planet, the universe, et cetera, even peace of mind, oneness, even our image, idealized image of oneness is not oneness. So we can say oneness is not oneness. Oneness will never be oneness. It's never been oneness. At no time is oneness ever oneness. At no time is oneness oneness, meaning our conceptualized image of oneness is never oneness. This actually is a rehearsal for choosing a new perception. It actually is. It's getting used to saying, wow. It's a rehearsing for it, saying, no, not, there's nothing out there that is really what I think it is. Nothing what I think. And just ready to experience the oneness where everything is devoid of qualities, of characteristics, as it were. they have no impact on the condition. It's not an ocean. It's not an ocean that you're not. It's not an ocean impacting how you feel. It's not impacting the oneness. So in doing this rehearsal, I found tremendous reaction, a profound reaction in me. And it's just like, wow, comes on strong. I said, oh, this is really effective, very effective. So I'm kind of like a test pilot. I'm testing this out for the rest of you to make sure that it's okay and it works. Now, I said in a previous video that I don't think there's going to be any spiritual revival, and I'm really depressed and down, said, nothing can happen. And now I'm saying, well, wait a minute, let's keep an open mind. It's not impossible that there could be a spiritual revival. It will require a set of circumstances in order to take place. It would literally have to be the employment of these exercises. It would have to be, because only that is fast enough to cut through and enable one to choose a new perception and to ascend, to relocate. It's actually, I can see, easy. By employing these exercises, you can easily shift dimensions, easily land, which is necessary. Relocation is absolutely necessary, unless you really want to descend, right? What we're perhaps having right now is descending really fast, like free fall. So we need to ascend. And the only way this can happen is to employ these exercises. Literally, people have to be going around saying, the Buddha is not the Buddha. The Buddha has never been the Buddha. Buddhism is not Buddhism. Enlightenment is not enlightenment. It's never been enlightenment. And no, at no time is enlightenment ever enlightenment. Saying kinds of things like this, just fracturing, demolishing the whole conceptual belief system of images, imagery, and conceptualization. And that gets ready for vision of oneness. It absolutely, that's how I'm seeing it very clearly. We'd actually have to be doing this. And it'd have to be a marathon. It would have to be a marathon. That's why I say the global challenge, like a 4-year marathon of as many people as possible on the planet doing this. It is possible. But there's only one way that can really happen, is there has to be some sort of really dynamic presence in the world of getting people started and doing this and saying, hey, this is what needs to be done. And trust me, this is just do it and let's do it. And then some people have to say, yeah, okay, we'll do it. That has to like sweep the globe. It has to sweep the globe like a global revival. But there has to be something pushing that. Just very dynamic, very dynamic. So it's possible. It's possible. The exercises will work. I really feel that they're simple and they work, and people just have to do it. But how can you convince people to do that unless there's something very dynamic, reassurance, very dynamic reassurance has to be there. Otherwise, people won't do it. If they don't do practice at this level, they're going to descend. We will descend. That's I can see it as clear as day. That is what will happen. You literally have to break through the eggshell right now. Have to break through the eggshell. Some people call it the matrix, the conceptual, the belief system of the ego. Some call it, you know, the conceptualization and imagery, idealized imagery, all that stuff. It's like an eggshell, and we're inside the eggshell, or a caterpillar has to break through and become a butterfly. Has to make that big push. Has to. Without that big push, it's not going to happen. So there's what I'm saying is there's nobody in this world who's dynamic enough to do this. I haven't found anybody who's that dynamic. There are some good teachers. There are some teachers that are working on this, but they cannot instigate a global revival, a global effort of people all over the planet, literally spending their time involved in these exercises for a 4-year period, constantly, you know, like a big movement, huge movement, where that's people get pulled in and say, yeah, we can do it, because there's a lot of people who could do it, and yet they feel they would be seen as idiots if they do it. You know, just imagine if you're saying this stuff out loud, people say you're a mental case. I'm sitting there saying, this tree is not a tree. This tree is not a tree. This road is not a road. I'm not going to even do that. People say, you need to go see a psychiatrist or something. What's the matter with you? So there has to be a legitimization of this very, very dynamic, compelling presence in the world that says, this is what you should do. This is what I'm standing behind. I'm backing this. And if somebody asks you why you're doing this, say, because I'm following this new approach, this global challenge. I'm taking up this global challenge to break through the conceptual barrier, to break through the matrix, as it were. And it's coming from on high. So, and this very dynamic presence will have others around that are very dynamic. And then people can start saying, hey, you know what? It's okay. And they won't have to be intimidated by the totalitarianism in the world that says if you step out of line, out of rank, you know, you got to be medicated or something. It's super intimidating to employ this type of approach, but it has to be employed. This is the only thing that works that I see will work. All the other stuff, it's not strong enough. This is strong medicine. When you start saying, get expanding it, the universe is not the universe. This planet is not the planet. This planet is not the planet. This planet is not this planet. You can do this, this ocean is not this ocean. Or you can say, this ocean is not the ocean. Or the ocean is not the ocean. Or this tree is not this tree. This tree is not a tree. You can do it in different formats. I'm trying out different formats to see which one is more powerful because I'm getting reactions from it. But it's along those lines, and you need to just practice it. And people together in groups can practice it, and you can have big meetings actually practice it, and people can get into it. And it just demolishes the resistance to changing perception. Choosing a new perception, not changing perception, choosing a new perception. We have to choose it. Now, there's one non-negotiable area with the ego that you absolutely have to stand firm, and this is the area the ego absolutely insists you have to negotiate on, and you cannot. And that is that perception is a choice. New perception is a choice. Perception is a choice. It's not a process. And the ego will insist that it's a process to say, what process brought this about? And you say, no process brought it about. It was a choice, my choice. Because on this pivotal point, the entire situation hinges on this. It hinges on this entirely. It's not a process, it's a choice. You know, the ego will insist that you explain the process, and you have to insist, no, there's no process involved. This is simply a rehearsal for a choice that I'm going to make. Otherwise, the ego will drag you down into all these explanations and you'll get very defensive. So you cannot negotiate this issue. So you need someone very dynamic who stands behind you and says, no, this is not negotiable, non-negotiable, this issue. It is a choice, and we are choosing to rehearse to make this choice. So without that kind of really dynamic legitimization, someone says, look, I'll take the responsibility. Of course, in this world, lawsuits will fly. They'll try to, you know, intimidate you through lawsuits. So many of super oppressive facets of this world, super oppressive, and lawsuits are among the worst. Someone will say, oh, this caused me to feel all unstable, and we're going to sue you for this and sue you for that. So there's somebody who has to take responsibility and say, go ahead, you can sue me all you want. We're going to keep doing this. There has to be this kind of total fearlessness involved in this situation. Without it, it can't get off the ground. The plane can't fly. It has to be this extraordinary fearlessness and an adamant spirit of freedom has to be present in this world. Otherwise, we won't do it. We won't do it. So I see it's possible. Theoretically, it's possible. And yet, without this dynamic presence, it's not possible. It's not possible. So I see the world is really just like sagging, descending, and we're all just kind of like cowering in fear. I don't want to rock the boat at all. I don't want to rock the ego's boat. But wouldn't it be great if the ego's boat was rocked? That would be great. I'd get into that for sure. Let's get into that. And people will throw all sorts of accusations at you. Ah, you're crazy, you maniac, egotist, all that. Just whatever it can throw, it'll throw everything possible to see one stick. I mean, you just have to just keep going right on doing the exercises and pay no attention. Pay no attention to it. These exercises are powerful. And again, put in the right context, they're absolutely brilliant, perfectly practical. But without this context, they seem completely insane, completely nutty, utterly nutty. So how do you withstand there will be people in your life that say, you've gone absolutely nutty. You're completely nutty. What are you doing sitting there saying, this tree is not a tree. It's never been a tree, never will be a tree. The sky is not the sky. This sky is not this sky. The sky has never been this sky. At no point in time is the sky ever the sky. There is no sky, as it were. But this sky is not this sky. That's better form, I think. And you're spending your time just insisting, negating every concept you can possibly do. This thought is not this thought. This thought is not this thought. These thoughts are not thoughts. This person is not this person. These people are not these people. These people are not these people. And you're spending your time practicing this, and they'll say you're completely nuts. You've gone completely insane. What are you doing? You imagine from their standpoint, they don't understand the context at all. They've been listening to the ego, so of course they don't understand. They're going to think you're completely nuts. So you have to have someone who's not unfazed by that, entirely unfazed. Now, it is possible, because I have seen there have been teachers in this world who are capable of doing that. So I say they came before. It could be a teacher in this world who's capable of doing that. It is possible. I just haven't come across it. I haven't come across it. And of course they're going to have all sorts of accusations hurled at them. See, this is some kind of crazy cult, some kind of suicide cult, and all this. They'll throw everything. So of course I'm testing this out on myself to see, you know, what's what. And it's a strain. It is a strain, yeah. But I'm fine. It's not any problem. Functionally, I'm fine. But it definitely is like, wow. You kind of feel like, holy smokes, I have the tools. I really have the key to unlock the door, as it were. I have the capability to go across the threshold. It's stepping across the threshold into a new perception is what it is. That's what it is. Stepping across the threshold to a new perception. And a new perception makes it easy to ascend. Easy to ascend. It makes everything easy, actually. In fact, there isn't any things at all anymore, so to speak. Things devoid of thingness, of qualities. How can you say they're things? It's a meaningless statement. All these things remain. The ocean remains there, but it's no longer an ocean. It's still there, but just no longer an ocean. It's not anything at all. It is the oneness. You see? So, this has been realized throughout the ages, but right now we need a global realization. Because we need global ascension. Because the situation is the descension is happening super rapidly. It's going to be a free fall. It's going to be a free fall. And without this revival, we'll be pulled down. Maybe a few might be able to be saved. Maybe like someone like myself who's able to do these exercises adamantly and understand the context and really feel it reverberating might be able to get free. I don't know. Maybe not. But with some adamant push, a big boost, many, many, many can get free now. Many. The world is going crazy. It's the world that's going crazy. We're the sane ones, as a matter of fact. Because we see the world is going nuts. It's always been nuts, but now it's coming out of the closet. The world is really coming out of the closet, is what is happening. And we realize the world is completely nuts. Totally insane. Always has been, always will be. And so... we're the sane ones by saying, "Whoa, we choose sanity. Let's choose a new perception, and solve the continuity problem, because this world is not solving the continuity problem for us, and continuity problem is the only problem we have, and this is not getting it done. It's not going to solve it the way it's going. In fact, it's the opposite. It's trying to insist on a continuity of just continuing on with dreams of trying to make death real. That doesn't solve the continuity problem. So we're the practical ones. We're the sane ones. We're doing what actually works." And they're doing, continuing along with what can never work. So that's complete eccentricity. Complete eccentricity. The world is totally eccentric. I can throw out so many examples. I don't think I should do that. They're just all around. It's shocking. Shocking what's happening. Absolutely shocking. if you're aware of it, you probably are being shocked. You see the headlines, you see this story, and you say, what in the world? And it's just more and more popping up like popcorn all the time. So the world is coming out of the closet, and it's not a pretty thing. The world's not a pretty thing. And of course, the world tells us that we're the ones that need sensitivity training, right? We need sensitivity training to learn how to love this futility. We're supposed to learn to love futility. Then we need sensitivity training is what they're going to tell us. You need re-education, you need sensitivity training, because you're saying derogatory things about the ego. And it's, oh, well, no, we're just saying we want to do what actually works to solve the continuity problem. And the ego keeps insisting that it should be in charge of solving the continuity problem. And the ego's a complete, eccentric, whimsical, moron, fool. The ego's completely insane, as it were, or completely whimsically eccentric, and has no understanding of how to solve the continuity problem in the slightest bit, and yet it's telling us that if we don't follow what it's telling us, its guidance, that we need re-education, we're derogatory, we need sensitivity training. Which is, of course, completely nuts. But the ego is incapable of realizing that it's completely nuts. So it will keep on its gibberish, it'll keep saying what it says, and people keep nodding their heads and bowing to it. So again, you have to have this parting of the ways, which is what is foretold is going to happen, is a parting of the ways. It is those who continue on with futility and those who go toward what actually works. And those who go to what actually works are helping the others greatly at some point. They'll all trickle down to them and they'll get the help they need. But without this dynamic presence in the world, it's not going to work, because the opposition is too strong. It's too strong. And we're getting sidetracked by so much stuff. The whole gun thing, for instance. We know what's going on. All right, let's not anyone kid themselves. We know exactly what's going on. So the answer is to do what's effective, solve the continuity problem. That's the answer. Because the world is going descending into absolute tyranny and madness. The answer is not to stockpile guns. The answer is to do these exercises so you can ascend, so you can relocate, so you can relocate out of the madness. Out of the madness. Get out of the madness. That's all I'm saying. So people ask, what side are you on? No, I'm reframing this whole situation. Get out of the madness. Of course they're coming for your guns. Of course. Of course they're heading. I mean, America's headed for a civil war. And the whole situation is just deteriorating. So the world's heading for World War III. The whole world, planet, is heading into just this complete collapse, as it were, into chaos, madness, tyranny, and just the worst stuff imaginable. And we need to get out of that. We need to get out of it. Don't be in that. Soup is like a boiling oil. You know, who cares who has a gun or doesn't have a gun when you're in a pot of boiling oil? That's not the issue anymore, is it? The issue is to get out of the pot of boiling oil. So there is a way to do it. These exercises will get you out of that pot of boiling oil. But you have to actually do them. Now, I've spent 35 years trying to get myself to do them, and only last week have I finally actually started doing them. Because the resistance to it is so strong. It's so strong because you realize they'll work. That's the problem. The problem is not that they don't work. The reason why I didn't do the exercises I could have done 35 years ago was because they work. Not because they don't work. I said, oh my God, if I do these exercises, I'm going to choose a new perception, and I will be in the vision of oneness, and that's kind of scary. And I will be able to ascend and all this stuff. And it's like, wow, society doesn't like that. So I kept trying to figure out a way to explain to society, explain why it's necessary. I spent all this time trying to conceptualize and explain and reason with everyone. But I guess it's useless. Really, you can't really explain to people who don't want to understand at all, who are engrossed in trying to make death real and survive. And then after death comes, well, in the after death state, as it were. It's not really afterlife, it's after death state, right? If you die, it's not an afterlife state, it's an after death state. So we call this the after world, the afterlife. It's not, it's the after death. And of course, we've imagined after death states and all that, but dwelling there eternally. But that's not reality at all. So you cannot really convince people who don't want to be convinced, to refuse to be convinced, who don't understand the context, who don't want to take the time, who don't want to do any of that. You can't force the horse to drink, lead it to water, but you can't force it to drink. So I finally realized, hey, you just have to start doing the exercises and just have to just do it and succeed. There's nothing else we can do at this point. At this point, I think the time for explanation has come and gone. It really has. But it makes it tough on us, because if we just start doing this, and like, remember the Hare, some of you don't remember this, but the Hare Krishnas, the Hare Krishna movement swept around the globe. And that was one type of exercise that some felt was profound. I didn't do that, but a lot of people did. They shaved their heads and they put on saffron robes and they had cymbals and stuff and danced around. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, or something like that. Hare Krishna, and it was kind of cool. It was kind of interesting. It's like, wow. I always admire their guts. You know, I always admire people that do stuff that society frowns upon like that. That's very benign. It's helpful, and society thought these guys are complete kooks. These people are complete kooks. They're really kooks. They're really nuts. But back at that time, they put up with it. You know, I said, it's okay. But these days, you don't see that happening, do you? You don't see it happening. My gosh, the Iron Curtain has descended upon this globe. It really has. We live now behind the Iron Curtain. It's a global Iron Curtain that has descended on this planet. And everybody's got a hammer out. And if any nail sticks up, the first thing they want to do is hammer that nail down. And I miss those times. I miss the 60s, I tell you. Good grief. Good grief. There was so much tolerance there. There's so much intolerance now. It's incredible. It's incredible. My gosh, the thought police are everywhere. And it was more than tolerance. It was open-mindedness, and it was respect. And you know, it was just like, in their own lives, most people's lives were happy enough at that time to say, well, these people aren't bothering my life. I'm coming home, I'm eating steak and potatoes, and we're having cocktail hour every evening, and we're going to drive-in theaters and movies, whatever. Life was good, sort of, back in the 50s and the 60s. And people said, well, people want to sit and chant Hare Krishna, shave their heads. Well, it's not hurting my life. I'm kind of happy. I think I'm really successful. So let them do what they would do. I don't care. But nowadays, people are so upset with their lives. Their lives are so terrible that they say, how dare those people think that I don't like or whatever. My life is miserable, and they're making it more miserable. I don't like that. So there's this overall feeling of wanting to crack down on everybody. Whereas back in the 60s, people said, hey, you know, hey, we're going on vacation here. And our life is, we don't need to pay attention to this stuff. Why even bother about it? It's not important. Whereas if your life is miserable, you're going to bother, everything's going to bother you. Everything's going to bother you. So there is the problem. There, the misery index is so high now at many levels. Materially, people might still be scraping by, but there's a lot of misery there too. But spiritually and underneath, there's total, extreme misery really in the world right now. Gosh, extreme staleness. We're bummed out. We're really bummed out. And we hate anybody that tries to be happy. You know, that says, hey, look at me. I'm free. I'm happy. I am happy. I am free, or whatever. We want to go, put them back in their miserable place like us. Misery loves company. Misery loves company, right? So there's a huge barrier there. What if you went on the street corner and was just like dancing and like Sri Chaitanya did back in Bihar and Bengal and all over India back in, I don't know, what was it, way centuries ago, just leading kirtan, sankirtan, walking throughout India, just chanting, going from village to village, and people would just come out, they'll just follow, and there's a huge procession throughout India, along the paths and highways and byways, of people just singing and chanting and getting into this very profound spiritual practice, actually. At that time, it was amazing. They'd come into town and they were so ecstatic that the villagers would just leave their houses, everybody just come and say, let's just go with this procession and put on to the next village. And it swept through Bengal and like a wildfire. Can you imagine that now? Can you imagine that, trying to go down your town where where you live, and just like you're completely ecstatic, and you're just in a golden robe, and you're just singing, and going into every store and singing to the people, and the police would descend on you like locusts. Ordinances, disturbing the peace, misdemeanor, citation. They throw all sorts of things, public disturbance. There's all sorts of stuff now they can throw at you that says that you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this. So, incredible, incredible tyranny. How do you break out of that is the question, really. How? I've been waiting a long time for some movement to break out of that. And it hasn't happened, which is very scary. Very scary. In other words, what should happen hasn't happened. What needs to happen hasn't happened. And that's scary. Very scary thing. It's almost lending credence to the idea of a sudden rapture, isn't it? Because if we can't get this revival going of people breaking through the conceptualizations and the barriers, the ideological barriers, and realizing the choice resides with us. The choice resides with us, within us. It's choice. The ego denies it. It says within us lies process, only process. That is a lie. Within us lies choice. We have the power of choice resides with me, resides with you, resides with us. The power of choice resides with us. We must exercise choice because choice is right now. Choice is how we get free of time. Okay? It's how I get free of time because choice is right now. Say, this tree is not a tree. Right now, it is not a tree. It is not a tree. We're denying thingness. We're denying thingness right now. Not saying it's a tree now, but in some process it will become not a tree. No, we're saying right now it is not a tree. That is super important. We have to rehearse this, of the power of choice. Really, beyond Eckhart Tolle's power of now is actually the power of choice. That's actually a higher way of looking at it. It really is. It really is. It's the power of choice. The power of choice is what needs to sweep through the world. And people need to, the real revolution is people to own their choice. They say, the power of choice is within me. To own it, and to rehearse it. And that revival should take place. And we can't keep waiting. My gosh, as we keep getting pulled down, every day we wait, we get pulled down even further. And I can talk about it very adamantly, but I can't go out in town and start leading some revival and out in the mass, you know, out in public and stuff. No, I'm not that type of person. I can follow along with that, but I'm not the type of person to do that. It takes a certain kind of, you know, fearlessness, total conviction, total certitude to do those kinds of things. It really takes something very extraordinary to do that. Very extraordinary. And again, the one you will know. I said the false messiah kind of thing. That's likely to happen too. I would say that there's a true messiah, false messiah, a good mother, a bad mother, so to speak. And both could come. We have to decide which is which. And it's easy because the good mother, as it were, to coax us out of this matrix. The bad mother to keep us in our seats, keep us in the matrix. Each one will be doing its thing. And the good mother coaxing us out of the matrix will insist on doing these exercises, will insist on it, saying, no, just do that. Forget about anything else, just do that. Whereas the bad mother keeping staying in your seat, just saying, oh, no, look at human potential. Look at how wonderful we can be. Let us just all love one another and let us... It'll be a very different thing. The good mother will insist on doing the exercises, including pointing everything out without exception. So we'll even say, the good mother is not the good mother. The good mother at no time is the good mother the good mother. She'll insist on that too. And no exceptions to anything. You have to completely break out of the conceptual barrier and cannot make an exception. Because how could there be an exception to oneness? If there's an exception to oneness, it's not oneness. If there's an exception to reality, something outside of reality, reality isn't reality then at all. That doesn't solve the continuity problem. So you will be able to tell the difference. You will. If there's a false and a true messiah come, which is quite likely, you'll be able to tell the difference. The true messiah the one who, those who, I don't know how many, it could be one, it could be many, I don't know, but those who insist on doing the exercises, forget about talking about it, it's time to do the exercises. And they will include themselves and everything, that yet, no exception. You say, Jesus is not Jesus, right? If Jesus came back, the first thing he'd tell you to do is say this exercise, Jesus is not Jesus. First thing you do. I think in Buddhism, there's a famous quote, Buddha saying the similar thing, Buddha is not Buddha. Don't trust Buddha at all. You must test yourself. You must know for yourself the power of choice within you. Don't accept the Buddha because the Buddha says that the Buddha is the Buddha. Forget it. That's right teaching. That is right teaching. It really is right teaching. So Jesus would say, no, Jesus is not Jesus. You must do this exercise. Jesus is not Jesus. At no point in time, at no time is Jesus ever Jesus. In other words, in time, process, there is no Jesus. No, there is no oneness. There is no perception of oneness. There is no solution of the continuity problem at all. None. None, 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 none. So there, you say, there is no Buddha. There is no Jesus. There is no Anandamaya Ma. Practice that way. That's profound practice. And say, like Anandamaya Ma, at no time was Anandamaya Ma in Ramana Park. At no time. Anandamaya Ma was never in Ramana Park. Never will be in Ramana Park. Anandamaya Ma is not Anandamaya Ma. Those kind of practices are what actually free you from what you need to be free from. And the real teachers, they know that this is true. This is true. This is what you have to do. And they're not the slightest bit barred. Where the false Messiah cannot handle that. The false Messiah feels that's undermining their effectiveness. And they hate that. They hate that. They want people to worship them. They want them to say, oh yes, you are the Messiah. No, you look at the Messiah and say, the Messiah is not the Messiah. This Messiah is not this Messiah. This Messiah is not this Messiah. This Messiah will never be this Messiah. That breaks you out of time, gives you the power of choice, takes you out of time and process, you see. So it works, it'll work. It'll work for anybody. It'll work for anyone if they do it, if they do it. So the only question is how to get people doing it. That's the only question. And it's possible. It's possible. I mean, I'd do it if someone was compelling enough to, I trust them and said, hey, they've got my back. Okay, so okay, I'll do it. They've got my back. But, you know, the guru's grace has my back, so to speak. Because, again, lawsuits will be thrown at people. They'll do everything possible be thrown at you. Everything possible. Imprisonment, lawsuits, whatever. Whatever they need to do to stop it, they'll try to do. And the grace of the guru protects from that. It should protect from that thing if you do the exercises. Because you're trusting in the guru at that point. Can't have it both ways. So, this is what I have to say, and it's a great thing, and I'm just hoping that something happens soon. And what happens, once you get the ball rolling, people start coming in off from all over the place, and then, really, it starts elevating. It starts elevating. You'll feel it. Global elevation, really. Global ascension can happen. There's a lot of teachers all over the planet with groups of people, but they're, you know, kind of hunkered down a little bit and like, I don't want to rock the boat. If they come out, all come out of the woodwork and say, yes, we can. Yes, we can do this. Yes, we can ascend. Yes, we can choose a new perception. Yes, we can. We can choose the perception of oneness. We can solve the continuity problem. Yes, we can do that. Yes, we can. Then it really could be incredible, really incredible. It is possible. It is possible. Will it happen or not? I don't know. I've always believed it will happen. Always worked towards this. Always felt like this is what's going to happen. But it's hard to predict the future in certain ways, isn't it? In certain ways, it's hard to predict the future. And I don't have any direct evidence that it will happen, actually. I can't say for sure it will. I can't say it won't, though. I can't say it won't. At times, I feel despondent and say, it's too late. And now I say, well, it's almost too late. But it's possible, it could happen, still happen. It's not totally impossible that it could happen. It's not. But it's certainly getting late in the game. I'm telling you that. Wow. Because the jackboots are marching, really marching in the world. I mean, the world's been Nazified. Let's be honest. The world has been Nazified. It really has. And the Iron Curtain has fallen on this planet. It really, really has. And it's going to just get crazy. It's going to become it's going to be absolutely mad here. Absolutely mad. It'll be a madhouse. And we literally have to already, we have to be comfortable of rehearsing for choosing a new perception. We have to get comfortable with it. We have to do the rehearsal. Without a rehearsal, how can we be expected to stand on the stage and deliver? No. You have to rehearse. You have to rehearse. And I know this is where the rubber meets the road. This is the tough one. It took taking me 35 years before I was willing to do these exercises. That's how tough it is. That's how much resistance there is. Why? Because it works. They work. That's why. And we kind of are afraid of what works and success. And we want company. Misery loves company. Success loves company too. Success loves company. Nobody wants to be alone. Success. That's no good. So people have tended to congregate into groups, and because they don't want to be alone. Success. But also in congregating into groups, I found that groupthink takes over, and it tends to stall things out because nobody wants to go ahead at all. Everybody wants to go slow as the slowest person, and it bogs down. So it's an interesting dynamic. You have to go super fast, and yet you don't want to be just a lone success. That's not good. You want to be surrounded by success. So that's why a revival is helpful, where you can start seeing success, and people start seeing success. Say, hey, if I'm successful, I'm not going to be alone. That's great. Let me do that. Let me go along with that. And you can build momentum that way. Big time momentum. It's possible to build it. You start out with someone who's perfectly certain, perfectly certain, and others say, hey, there's one who's perfectly successful. I'm gonna go with that too. Okay, I won't be alone. Then they go with it. And then others see that and they go with it. And it expands exponentially. 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 So this is something that really can't be done just on a all alone. I just find it's too difficult. It is too difficult. You have to have some sort of dynamic of others also succeeding. So that's what we're hoping for. That's what I'm hoping for. And I'll keep you up to date on whatever comes. But I can tell you that these exercises, maybe I'll put a video up, another one, helping show you how these exercises are done a little more clearly. And you can even get started. You don't have to say anything out loud. Wasn't saying anything out loud. I'm just driving. In my mind, I just say, I didn't say anything out loud, just in my mind, this road is not this road. This road is not this road. This road is not a road. The road. The road is not a road. The road is not a road. The road, at no time is the road a road. At no time is the road a road. At no time is this mountain a mountain. This mountain is not the mountain. The mountain is not the mountain. This mountain is not this mountain. And it's not an intellectual thing. You feel it deeper with like a adamant kind of feeling, like you have every right to say this. It's more like that. It's not an academic, conceptual, intellectual thing at all. No, it's not an intellectual exercise. It's not an emotional exercise. There's something deeper. It's like a declaration of freedom. It's a declaration of freedom coming from you. This road is not a road. This road is not a road. I say it that way. It is not a road. It's a kind of very feisty declaration of independence from conceptualization, from this whole dream of fragmentation, from this perception of fragmentation and death. You're declaring your independence. It's really a declaration of independence. We need a new declaration of independence in the world. We need a declaration of global independence from insanity, from futility, from the ego. From this terrible belief system that we're of trying to make death real. We need a global declaration of independence. So we'll drop that document. Someone needs to draw it up and get it going. So we'll see what happens. It's an amazing time right now. So don't give up your hope. Don't give up your hope. Don't let me. Some of the videos I had before, it's like, oh my gosh, maybe it's not going to happen. Well, no, that's maybe a little premature. Jump the gun a little bit. It still could happen. Let's not give up hope. We can make a declaration of global independence, and I will keep trying to provide stuff for you that will keep you going. And just try the exercises. Maybe the first time you do it, it'll just be an intellectual thing. Second time, you might feel something. Third time, third day, you might start getting a little more adamant. Fourth day, more. Like today, I found myself being very adamant, and I could bringing this charge to what I was saying, and it felt tremendous. You know, like wow. It was like incredible breakthrough, almost a feeling of incredible breakthrough. This sky is not the sky. This sky is not the sky. Remember when you were told when you're young, all these things had labels, and you were forced into that. And I always say, no. That takes a vision of oneness, and you were schooled into this perception of thingness. Now you're saying no more to that perception. No, I'm choosing the perception of oneness, and I'm adamant about it, and I'm insist upon it. This tree is not a tree. 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 This tree has never been a tree. This tree will never be a tree. This tree is not this tree. This tree is not a tree. See, that kind of very, repeat that. This tree is focused. This tree is not a tree. This tree is not a tree. This screen is not a screen. It is not a screen. At no time is a screen ever a screen. It is not a screen. There's never been a screen. It will never be a screen. This screen is not this screen. A screen is not a screen. There is no screen. This screen is not a screen. This screen is not a screen. And say it this way. It's there's something different than intellect and different than emotion. Call it heart. You can call it heart, whatever you want to call it. Adamant heart. Adamant heart. Talk from the heart like that. And just you are insisting, insistence. It's this heartfelt insistence of calling upon your freedom, and you're insisting that the power of decision, the power of choice lies within you. It absolutely does. And you can choose whether to see it as a tree, or you can choose to see it, this tree is not a tree, and see the oneness. It's a choice. You got the right to choose. Nobody can tell you that it's a tree and insist that you must stick with that tree and that process of treeness, and that there's no other perception you can choose. Nobody has the right to insist upon that and tell you that. You have every right to insist that tree is not a tree. That tree has never been a tree. It will never be a tree. In other words, you insisting on the vision of oneness. That is exactly what you're insisting on, and you're rehearsing it. So it is super important to do that, to actually do it now. Because the collapse is, the spiritual collapse, the descent is free fall right now. Free fall is madness. It is just madness what's going on. Don't wait for the madness to come to your door. You can see it swarm. You see the mob swarming. Don't come in your door. Take it. Steal a march on it. Be smart. Say, hey, I see the tsunami coming. Don't wait till it hits the beach before you head for the hills. You know, there's some people on the beach and the tsunami came, they're looking at it, just kind of looking, what's that? Huh, it's a big wave. Yeah, wow, big wave's coming in. Wow, it looks kind of scary. And they say, well, what do I do? I don't know. They wait till it gets the beach. They say, oh my gosh, it's on the beach? Oh my God, too late. The smart ones say, hey, look, the entire tide is going down, descending. And the tide is getting way too low suddenly. This is supposed to be high tide, and the whole tide is like so low that everything's being exposed, the bedrock, the whole bottom of the ocean's being exposed. This is completely abnormal. And the only thing that could cause this is a huge tsunami is coming. Of course, get the heck out of here right now. Get the heck out of here right now. Don't sit around saying, huh. Don't go out on the ocean, exposed ocean bottom and look at it and say, wow, look at all this, the starfish and the crabs and the shellfish and the clams and the seaweed. Look at all this stuff. How interesting. Wow, this is really cool. Nature walk time. No, it's completely nuts, eccentric to do that. Say, wait a minute. This means it must have been some massive earthquake and there's some huge ocean tsunami coming, a wave coming. I got to get out of here as fast as possible. That's just being common sense. Common sense. Really, the whole situation now is just practical common sense, and yet people have been educated out of their common sense. Badly educated out of their common sense. They want to wait till the mob lynches them and before they say, oh, wait a minute, I better do something about this. Oops, it's too late. Don't wait till it's too late. Only an eccentric would do that. Employ common sense. Common sense is to get start doing these exercises, and I will provide some tools to do that. I'll start working on it. But a lot of stress, a lot of pressure right now. But no excuse. Have to keep doing it. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.